Welcome to Sabbath School, brought to you by It Is Written. I'm Eric Flickinger, your host, and with me once again as we continue delving into present truth and Deuteronomy is the author of the lesson, Clifford Goldstein. Cliff, welcome back once again.
Glad to be back.
So this is week number three. We've covered the introduction. We've got into some of the meat of it now, and we're getting to lesson number three, which is the everlasting covenant. Now, the everlasting covenant, that word everlasting implies something. What does that imply?
Well, long,
very
old,
long.
Old and long. And, you know, it is interesting because you can find, you know, some of these, you know, the Bible, you know, when you're a new believer, I remember I was 23 when I was born again, right before my 24th birthday, and I knew nothing. I remember, I mean, I'm Jewish, but I wasn't raised. I remember asking somebody once, was King David Jewish? And the guy looked at me like, you gotta be kidding me, but that's how biblically illiterate I was. And then I become born again and I come into the world of the Bible. I mean, I really knew nothing. And I remember reading one time, you know, Jesus, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Well, wait a minute, wasn't that 2,000 years ago? And then, of course, I started to understand, and you've got other Bible texts, like I think in Timothy, Paul says that God, who cannot lie, gave us the promise of eternal life before time began. And that's very interesting. I don't want to get into all this cosmogony and all this, but in light of the idea that the universe was created, the Big Bang Theory, okay, and I joke sometimes, I say, God said bang, and there it was, okay? So anyway, however you understand it, but it was once believed that the universe didn't exist, and that when they have this thing, they call it a singularity, you know, because they atheists have a hard time saying where that came from. But let's assume God created that way. There's this infinitely hot, infinitely dense singularity, and it exploded. And out of this came space, matter and energy, which are the same thing, basically, and time. Now, as hard as that is to wrap our mind around, but it's the idea that time had a beginning. Okay, now, again, I don't know when the author, when Paul wrote this, I'm sure he wasn't thinking of that, but the point is, the plan of salvation was there in eternity. It wasn't like, well, this problem came and we got to figure out how to do it. From the beginning, God knew what was going to happen. And sometime in the love of the Godhead, okay, in the love of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, it was planned. See, it comes back. We touched on this before. You know, God can force every creature in the universe to worship him. He can force every creature in the universe to obey him. But he can't force a single creature to love him.
Can't be done.
Love to be love has to be freely given. I mean, really free. And that was a risk to make him free. And God, the fall didn't take God by surprise. In eternity past, the Godhead knew what was going to happen and said, okay, we can handle this. And it was through the everlasting covenant, the plan of salvation put in. So really, when it's saying everlasting, it's going back to eternity. Sometime in this was put, and it was put in, it was there, and now it's being made manifest in biblical times. We're learning it with the fall. So that's my understanding. So what ancient Israel picked up on, they were the people. They were the people that were to reveal this whole plan of salvation to the world. So that's, in a nutshell, my understanding.
And we're back all the way in the book of Genesis talking about this. In Genesis 17, verse 7, which is the memory text for this week, it says, I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you and their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and your descendants after you. And so that, it just goes all the way
forward. That was in Genesis.
Forward.
Yeah, that was God speaking to Abraham. Yeah.
All the way back.
To his, So, but of course it started even before then.
Right.
You know, we believe right in the Garden of Eden, it was first made manifest after they fell.
Mm-hmm.
And the plan was there in Eden, but then it was something that was, I said before, I mean, I don't know when before time began was. All I know, it was a long time ago. Okay. And that's what, and that's the important thing. This wasn't anything new. And so now it's being made manifest through the Bible people, through, and particularly through the children of Israel.
And we see this everlasting gospel extending from way back, however far back that was, long before you and I arrived on the scene.
Before the world was created.
Before the world was created. And we come all the way to our time and beyond over in Revelation chapter 14, 6, which is part of the three angels' message, which is really present-day Bible truth
present
for
truth.
Us. Yeah. Present truth for us. In Revelation 14, 6, John writes, "Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people." So this is that everlasting gospel pictured in our day.
Sure. Yeah, it's another manifestation of it. But this is what God gave to Adam and Eve in Eden. It's what he had to Abraham. I mean, we see it in what they, Sunday's lesson. It's very interesting. Sunday's lesson goes back. It says, even from the start, the central truth of the covenant was the gospel, salvation by faith alone. And in Genesis 15, the Lord speaks to Abraham, and he tells him what he's going to do. And then you got this beautiful, this short verse that Paul later picks up on him. The Lord said, you know, he says to him, then he brought him outside, look toward the heaven, count the stars if you can count it. And he said to him, thus will be your seed. And then here's this famous verse that Paul picks up on thousands of years or whenever it was later. I guess it wasn't thousands. I guess where do you date Abraham? I don't know. But it was much later. Okay, Paul, but in Genesis 15, 6, this is because, folks, here is the gospel.
Mm.
Here is salvation by faith alone. Because, you know, there's this idea, well, the Israelites were saved by the law and by their works, and we're saved by grace today. And then you got some theologies where there's a final generation that's going to be saved by works.
Yeah.
Okay? And that's what, you know, but no, it never works that way.
Right.
And it says here, Genesis 15, 6, and he believed the Lord, and it was the Hebrew word here, hashav, the root word is to think. Think. You know, a lot of times it just means to think, and it's in a form here, it's called a hifil. It's a causative form. It's like, and it was caused to be credited to him, and it was thought to him as righteousness. In other words, he believed, and by believing, that was thought to him as righteousness. That's the gospel. It didn't say he made him righteous. So you could argue that becomes part of it. We're made righteous. We're changed. We live out the righteousness, but that's not enough to save us. Okay? It says, and he believed in the Lord, and it was credited to him as righteousness. And then Paul comes, then later Paul comes in the book of Romans, Romans 4, you know, and he uses Abraham. And he uses Abraham believed in God's promises. And it said, and he says here, even though his faith is counted as righteousness, Paul is quoting that, okay? Even though later, we saw these amazing manifestations of Abraham's faith. I think particularly at Mount Moriah.
Sure.
You know,
sure.
I don't know if you ever had this. I remember we had family worship one time. My six-year-old daughter, we read the story. And my six-year-old daughter said, Dad, would you do that to me?
Mm.
What do you say to a six-year-old? And I went to my default mode. I told her the truth. I said no.
Mm.
I said, no, I wouldn't have done it, okay? You know, so, you know, whatever. I'm not ashamed of what I said, but you got to remember, Abraham was in a total different culture then, though I'm sure it wasn't any easier. But the point is, that's not what justified him. Mm. He was accounted righteous back there in Genesis, you know, early Genesis, when he believed God's promise and it was accounted to him as righteousness. And that's another manifestation of the everlasting covenant, the gospel. As a result of that, he was faithful, but it was God saves you by his grace, and then you live accordingly. So
that's the response, and it's the same today. Abraham saved the same way that you and I would be saved, the same way that our children or grandchildren, if time should last, would be saved as well. And it's a beautiful picture that we have right there on Sunday's lesson about the covenant and the gospel.
And look at here, you want to see it again? You want to see the same idea again as here in Deuteronomy,
because
that was the whole point, Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 9:5, and I'll just read it in the English, because it's very easy Hebrew to read in Deuteronomy, thank goodness, because some of those poets can get really rough, okay. Yeah. But he says here, he's saying to Israel what he's going to do for them, and he says, it is not because of your righteousness or the uprightness of your heart that you to go to possess the land. I mean, here it's the gospel. God did it for them because he's righteous. You know, they didn't deserve it. But here it is, and this comes back, something that we touched on before, and which helps deal with that difficult thing of having them kill those people. But because of the wickedness of these nations, that the Lord your God drives them out before you, and that he may fulfill the word which the Lord swore to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So you see, it's very clear that it's not like they were so great and so holy. It was despite the fact that they weren't.
Mm.
Nevertheless, despite it, he's going to deal with those evil people, and then he's going to fulfill the word which the Lord swore to their fathers.
And that's good news for us today, you know, because if he's taking care of them back then, and
here
we are living at the end of time, and one could make an argument that the world is worse off today than it was back then. We're in pretty bad shape today.
It's pretty scary, yeah.
But if they had hope back then, we certainly have hope today. And that's what we're looking at today, the present truth of the book of Deuteronomy and the everlasting gospel. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That means that if he was hard at work saving people back in those times, he is very much hard at work saving people in our times. I want to encourage you to pick up the companion book to this quarter's Sabbath School lesson. You can find it on It Is Written's shop. You will receive a blessing as you delve into it and continue looking at present truth in the light of the book of Deuteronomy. I'm going to be back in just a moment with Clifford Goldstein as we continue diving into week number 3. We'll be back in just a moment.
You know that at It Is Written, we are serious about the study of the Word of God, and we encourage you to be serious about God's Word also. Well, I want to share with you another way that you can dig deeper into the Word of God, and here it is. itiswritten.study. Go online to itiswritten.study and you can access the It Is Written Bible Study Guides, 25 in-depth Bible studies that will walk you through the Bible. It's going to be good for you, and it's the sort of thing that you will want to tell somebody else about, so that they can dig deeper into the Word of God and come to know the things of the Bible intimately. As you get into the It Is Written online Bible study guides, you'll understand the prophecies of the Bible, the plan of salvation, and more. So don't forget, itiswritten.study. itiswritten.study.
Welcome back to Sabbath School, brought to you by It Is Written. I'm here once again with Clifford Goldstein, and we're diving into the book of Deuteronomy. This is week number 3, and we're going to take a look at Tuesday's lesson. Tuesday's lesson is fascinating because it talks about the book of the covenant. And I really want to focus on Deuteronomy chapter 5. We're not going to read all of verses 1 through 21, but they're going to be very familiar to you as we start looking at them. But I do want to take a look quickly at verse number 3. Deuteronomy 5 verse 3 says, "The Lord did not make this covenant with our fathers, but with us, those who are here today, all of us who are alive." Now, if we were to read down through verse number 21, this would look familiar because, of course, this is the Ten Commandments. So we've got the Ten Commandments here that God is giving to His people again.
That's why they call it the Deuteronomy.
Second
Deutero,
law.
Second nomos, law.
So okay. Second giving of the law right here. This is the heart of the book of Deuteronomy, the second giving of the law. But as we look at the Ten Commandments, most of them look familiar. And when we start reading the fourth commandment, it starts to look familiar too. Observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy. This is verse number 12, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days labor and do all your work and so on and so forth. And then we get down to verse number 15 and things kind of take a bit of a left turn here a little bit, or at least they appear to. It says, "And remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there by a mighty hand and by an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day." Now, we don't find that in the original giving of the Ten Commandments in the book of Exodus, but here it is. So how do we reconcile that?
Well, again, I don't know how much was written, you know, when he wrote on the stone. Did he remember the Sabbath day? Did he have the whole commandment written out? You know, I don't know. I'd have to go back and think about that. But he's giving them the Ten Commandments. But you see, well, look at it this way. All right, it's great that God created us. We wouldn't be here. But, you know, to just have created us and just to have left us, and, you know, oh, great, I'm born, yeah, and then, you know, I struggle, and we talked about this, I think, and then I die, you know, and there's pain and suffering, and even if you live a pretty good life, I mean, all around the evil and what you see people going through. So, all right, it's great that God had created us, but we need more than that.
Mm.
Okay.
Much more.
We need more than that. We need redemption.
Mm.
This world is a fallen world. This world is a broken world. We live, we suffer, we die. And unless it was the poet Auden who once said, "We who must die demand a miracle." Because Otherwise, and well, we have the miracle in the gospel, in the everlasting covenant, you know, fulfilled with the death of Jesus. So anyway, the bottom line here is, so the first version of the fourth commandment, the one at Sinai, you know, to keep the Sabbath, because God is the creator. He is our creator, and that's the foundation of everything. You know, think about this too. What doctrine is so important that God demands 1/7 of our lives every week to keep, you know, to remember? It's the creation.
Right.
You know, all the other doctrines, the cross means nothing in a universe God didn't create. Jesus would be another crucified Jew. What are we redeemed from? So nothing we believe. That's why, you know, the Bible doesn't start out with a statement about the three angels' message, a statement about the second coming, a statement about the law, the everlasting gospel. It starts out with creation, because that's the foundation of everything. And so, and it's so important that 1/7 of our lives, and we don't have to go to it.
Mm.
It comes to us. So important is this commandment that it follows up. You know, I have this app, it's on here, it's called Living Earth, and it's real-time satellite. You can see the Earth, you know, it's beautiful. You can look at the clouds, you know, and so on. And I mean, it'd be a little weird to sit there and look at the Sabbath. It's just the darkness coming over the globe. But you see, it circles the globe. That's how important creation is. But This here was said in the beginning, the pulling them out of Egypt was a symbol of redemption. They didn't deserve it. They couldn't do it themselves. It was only the miracles of God, and they come to the Red Sea or whatever, the Yom Suf, and you know, the Lord spreads it and they go through. It was totally the supernatural work of God in redeeming him. And so what I think here is embedded then in the Ten Commandments, in the law, in the everlasting covenant, is okay, I'm your creator and I'm your redeemer. You were slaves. You were, remember that, Eved Hayita. Now it's interesting too, how does yours translate? Deuteronomy 14:5. You remember key. How does it read?
Remember that you were a slave in the land
of
Egypt.
Okay, good. They translated it correctly. You were a slave.
Mm.
And so it's almost as if, and you find this a lot of ways through the book of Deuteronomy, he speaks to them. So in Hebrew, you've got singular and plural. You've got you as you alone, and you got you as you guys,
mm-hmm.
plural, okay? And we don't make that distinction in English. It's just you one or 50, okay? But here, it says, and he says, Zikarta, you singular, you remember ki eved hayita be'eretz Mitzrayim, that you were a slave. So, and I always thought this was interesting because I think he's speaking to them as individuals. You know, you're not saved in a group.
Mm.
You could have been a member of ancient Israel, and you can go, you know, there are going to be people who were born and raised in ancient Israel, went to the temple, did that, and they're going to go to hell. Okay, they're going to be destroyed. And you know, you see what I'm saying?
Sure.
So it's not a corporate thing. It's not, I mean, well, one sense, he's speaking to them corporately, but he's speaking to each one individually mm-hmm. in the corporate thing. In turn of salvation, they are saved individually. So anyway, but you each were slaves in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you from there, and so on, and he commands you to keep the Sabbath. Anyway, I thought it's creation and redemption built into the Sabbath commandment.
And he does that in Exodus and in Deuteronomy, just to bring those two pieces together.
Because again, without redemption, creation, well, thanks, God, but no thanks.
Right.
You know, you live here and you go through all this and no hope.
Mm.
I mean, I read, it's funny, I've been reading, I just finished a book by a woman. I've read it, she's a hardcore, she grew up in an atheist home. In fact, her father used to read to them, Robert Ingersoll. Okay, Ingersoll was this 19th century atheist apologist. So she grew up in such an atheist home that the father would read that. I mean, I grew up in an atheist home, but we were kind of Laodiceans. You know, we never talked about it much. Here, the atheism was hammered into her. But when she was 9 or 10, she started thinking about the situation, she called it. And the situation was, hey, we're all going to die. Okay, and what does this all mean? And the book is, she calls, Living with a Wild God, My Search for the Truth About Nearly Everything.
Hmm.
Okay, and it was, but the funny thing about, the point I want to get to was, time, as much as she fights it, she keeps being drawn to some kind of transcendence. As much as she doesn't want to, because creation alone ain't enough.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Even atheists can see that because we face this demise. And so the bottom line here is what we see here is creation and redemption together.
And in order to, or maybe that's the wrong way to say it, God redeems us, Christ redeems us because we are special to him. He loves us. He wants to be with us. Over in the book of Deuteronomy again, chapter 26, I want to jump over there very quickly. Deuteronomy chapter 26. Looking at verses 16 through 19, there's another passage here that I think is beautiful. And this comes from Wednesday's lesson, his special people. Deuteronomy 26. This day the Lord your God commands you to observe these statutes and judgments. Therefore you shall be careful to observe them with all your heart and with all your soul.
This is beautiful. With all your heart, all your nefesh. Yeah, your net. We translate it soul. It's life, really, with all your heart, with all your life. Anyway, go ahead.
Yep. So he continues here, verse 17, today you have proclaimed the Lord to be your God, and that you will walk in his ways and keep his statutes, his commandments, and his judgments, and that you will obey his voice. Also today, the Lord has proclaimed you to be his special people, just as he promised you that you should keep all his commandments. So there seems to be an emphasis here, and also in verse 19, that he will set you above all nations, which he has made in praise, in name, in honor, and that you may be a holy people to the Lord your God, just as he has spoken.
Am kadosh ladonoi Eloheka, holy people to your God. This comes back again to the theme we've talked about from the beginning. I mean, God was doing this because he loved him, but there was still this missionary purpose here. By obeying these things, by doing these things, they would be exalted. And I guess that was part of the problem. They got exalted, and then we'll come to that later. He warns about that, but that was the idea. It's all right here. It's all right here.
So all the way back in the book of Deuteronomy, and of course, you know, further back than that, as we've been talking about, is this idea of essentially the Great Commission. Now, he was wanting to use that people back in that time to share the good news, to share the gospel. Of course, that mantle, if we want to use that term, has been passed to us today as Bible-believing Christians to share the good news, the everlasting gospel, the gospel message with the world. And that's something that you have on your shoulders. It's a mantle that we have on our shoulders. And it's something that we're seeing here clearly in the book of Deuteronomy. God loves his people. He loves everyone on earth, not just his own special people back then, his called out people back then, but he's got a people today. That's those of us who love Jesus, who believe in Jesus, who have accepted and received Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. That's one of the big reasons why the book of Deuteronomy today is so applicable to us. It is a picture of what God wants to do with his people to share the message with the rest of the world. And so we've dug into that this week as we continue our study of the book of Deuteronomy. And we'll be back again next week as we continue looking at present truth in the book of Deuteronomy. Thank you once again, Cliff, for being with us this week. We're looking forward to having you with us again next week, and we'll see you then. God bless you.